Now, this is a very special day in the life of our congregation, as we are privileged to welcome two important figures in the history of our church. Now, one of the reasons that it's important is that they're here, but another reason is that today is the 129th anniversary of the land run that opened up this part of Oklahoma. Tomorrow is the 129th anniversary of this congregation. Because it started, the land run was on a Saturday, and the following day, the Baptists, the disciples, the Methodists, the Presbyterians, all met as a group. And the next Sunday, there were four congregations. Because they wanted to have a unified service that first Sunday to show that they were going to work together. And I think they have throughout the years. So we are excited to have Alexander Campbell here with us and Mr. Barton W. Stone. Gentlemen, welcome to First Christian Church of Oklahoma City.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
Mike. Turn your mic on, Alex.
Newfangled stuff.
So welcome again.
Welcome again. Yes, thank you so much.
Yes, thank you. I, too, am glad to be with you today.
Now, both of these men are considered founders of the religious reform movement, which has become known as the Christian Church Disciples of Christ, and therefore...
Excuse me, but I would just like to make it clear that the complex name you just mentioned, Christian Church Disciples of Christ, was not my idea. I believe it is too long simply calling ourselves disciples should be sufficient.
So I see you're going to insist on continuing that debate of yours. You see, there's one thing that Brother Campbell and I could never agree on, and that is the name. He insists on disciples.
But for the obvious reason that it is sufficient, accurate, and makes absolutely clear that we are followers of Jesus Christ.
But Brother Campbell, since unity of all believers is one of the guiding principles on which we do agree, then the name Christian is sufficient. It is also, I might add, accurate, and makes absolutely clear who we are.
Possibly. But it doesn't express it strongly enough. The word disciples makes it clear that we are indeed, as I said, followers of Jesus Christ.
And so does Christians.
All right, gentlemen. Excuse me for interrupting, but there are many things about which you do agree. Okay? So let's focus on some of those for a little while.
Well, you are correct. We should not let Brother Stone's mistaken notion about the name get in the way of our discussion.
Mr. Campbell, take just for a moment, if you would, and tell us about your childhood and how you came to America.
Okay, certainly. I was born in Ireland in 1788. My father, Thomas, was a Presbyterian minister. And by the way, is also considered one of the founders of our movement. I should also mention that we never set out to create a new denomination, especially one with such a long name. My father and I were simply bothered by some of the things we saw happening in our Presbyterian church. My father came to America in 1807 and settled near Western Pennsylvania. He was given a congregation there, and once he was settled, he sent for the rest of us. We were due to make the trip, you see, in 1807, but a shipwreck kept us in Europe another year. And that delay turned out to be a benefit for me, because it was during that year I studied at the University of Glasgow.
Well, what did you study?
Oh, some simple things. Greek, logic, philosophy, natural science. I love them all. In fact, that experience has had much to do with my belief in the importance of education. Several colleges have been started by disciples. Phillips University?
Yeah. Was religion a significant part of your study at the university?
Oh, my. My goodness. Religion was very prominent. Chapel services were each morning at 5. Like your congregation, I understand, is a 5 o'clock one in a week or so. Officers made sure we engaged in private devotions and scripture study each day. There were church services on Sunday morning and sermons on Sunday afternoon. And then on Sunday night, there was an examination on both sermons, plus discussions of the theological issue. There was a rather large amount of emphasis on religion.
I would say so. So, Mr. Campbell, was there anything else about your time in Glasgow that you had an impact on you other than your studies at the university?
Well, two things, really. First, I was very troubled by all of the quibbling between denominations. Churches were quibbling with one another and not lending to the important business of preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. Second, I was horrified at the church's failure to respond to the miserable conditions in Glasgow. It was the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, you see. Children were forced to work long hours in the factories. Housing was deplorable. Poverty was rampant, and I found this so hard to believe. The church seemed to go along with the elite, the upper crust. The church did nothing to address these horrible conditions. I was appalled. It did not take me long to decide that I would leave the organized church.
So did you leave the organized church or did you stay with it?
Well, I did not. I associated myself with a group of reformers who are sometimes called Scotch Baptists. I found their views comparable and compatible with my own, and it should be pointed out that it was during my time with them that I became convinced for the need of the Lord's Supper each week. That clearly seems to be the practice of the first century Christians. And while Brother Stone and I may disagree on some things, another of the guiding principles upon which we agree is that we need to look to the New Testament for guidance in the way we conduct our lives. Isn't that correct, Brother Stone?
Yes, that is correct.
So, Mr. Campbell, when did you get to the United States, to America?
Well, the next year, 1808, my father met us in Philadelphia. And he and I discovered that we had reached similar conclusions about the church. We tried working within the existing church because we really did not want to start a new denomination. Quite the contrary, we preferred to see an end to denominations. Call us all disciples and be done with it. And after some time with Presbyterians, we united with the Baptists. But we struggled with them too, and finally gathered with believers who shared our views and stayed outside any organized denomination.
Well, thank you, Mr. Campbell. I want to hear about Mr. Stone's early days, and then I would like for the two of you to speak about how you came together, about those guiding principles you referred to. Would that be acceptable to both of you?
Yes, indeed.
Yes, of course.
Okay, Mr. Stone, as I understand it, you are the only one of the four principal founders of our reform movement who was actually born here in this country.
You are correct.
Would you tell us about your early years in Maryland and Virginia?
It would be an honor. I was born in Maryland in 1772. My family was prominent in Maryland politics. In fact, one relative, Thomas Stone, was one of the Maryland signers of the Declaration of Independence. My father died just before the start of the Revolutionary War, and my mother sold the farm in Maryland and moved to Southern Virginia near the North Carolina border. I received some inheritance because of my father's death, and I used it for my education. I enrolled at Guilford Academy, which was a community now known as Greensboro, North Carolina.
What did you study?
Well, when I began, I was intending on a career in law. So my studies were focused in that direction, but that changed after hearing some of the preachers who visited Guilford Academy. One in particular changed my life.
Who was that?
William Hodge. He spoke about a year after I'd begun my studies at Guilford Academy, and it had been a difficult year. Early on, I had heard fiery sermons from Calvinists who preached hellfire and damnation. They left me afraid, confused, and in fact, frankly depressed. Then Brother Hodge spoke, and his message changed my life. You see, instead of hellfire and damnation, he emphasized the love of God. And it became clear to me then that the gospel of Jesus Christ is good news. Good news for all believers, including me. It is not an overstatement to say that his sermon changed my life. And it was after hearing him that I decided to abandon my intentions of a career in law and instead enter the ministry.
Did you stay in North Carolina?
I did for a time. Then I went to Bourbon County, Kentucky, which is north of Lexington, and became the pastor of two Presbyterian churches, one at Cane Ridge and the other at Concord.
Were you ordained?
Yes, I was, although I must share with you that even in the process of being ordained, I let it be known that I would not follow church doctrines that were not consistent with the gospel. I recall being asked during my ordination exam if I received and adopted the Confession of Faith, our creed, as containing the system of doctrine taught in the Bible. And I answered, I do, as far as I see it consistent with the Word of God. Well, that raised an eyebrow or two.
Brother Stone and I each found some satisfaction, I'd say, in raising the eyebrows of denominational officials.
I'm sure you did. Some of us think that needs to be done from time to time today.
Mm-hmm. Well, good for you.
Yes, good for you.
Mr. Stone, tell us about the big revival at Cane Ridge. That must have been quite an event.
Oh, yes. Yes, it was. There were big revivals throughout the country in those days, but the largest, if I may say so, was at Cane Ridge. The Cane Ridge Camp Meeting, we referred to outdoor revivals as camp meetings in those days, and it was held for a week in August of 1801. At any one time, there were 15,000 people there and a total attendance for the week of 25,000. And during that week, several preachers stood up on tree stumps and they got up on wagons and they preached the gospel. There was much singing and prayer and communion. It was a stirring sight to see thousands of people from different denominations worshiping all together. That, I'm convinced, is what Christians are called to do. Remove the barriers that separate us and get about the business of preaching the good word about Jesus Christ.
May I say something?
Of course, Mr. Campbell.
I certainly agree that Brother Stone, about the importance of removing barriers which separate us. That said, I must make it clear that I was troubled by these highly emotional revivals. People's bodies would jerk, and sometimes they made wild sounds like barking, and there were many who simply fainted. Such behavior is, to me, highly questionable.
Are you presuming to say that God cannot stir people in such ways?
Well, no, of course not. I am, however, unconvinced that God is responsible each time someone faints. It would seem that the better way to come in to know God is through rational, informed study and inquiry, not some emotional experience that will run its course in a short time and leave the believer bereft of meaning.
Well, with all due respect, Brother Campbell, I believe you're underestimating the power and the presence of God. I must admit that I too found difficulty with some of the things I witnessed, and I can't deny that people had encounters with God and that their lives were changed as a result. So I submit to you that an emotional encounter with the living God can be every bit as legitimate and life-changing as rational
inquiry. Now, okay, gentlemen, we need to move on, but let me assure you that even today this debate continues about which methods are legitimate as we seek to encounter God. So this is not something that went away. Now let's switch to a different subject. It is clear that there are some things about which you disagree, which makes it a bit of a mystery as how you were able to come together and bring your movements together. How did that happen?
Well, of course, neither of us was seeking a merger, to use one of your modern words. Rather, we were both at work in our respective locations. I had settled in Bethany, Virginia, now West Virginia, and Brother Stone was in Kentucky.
And each of us was publishing a newspaper. There were a lot of them in those days, and people actually read them.
They read them because they did not have so many other diversions like television, movies, professional sporting events, and the internet and cell phone.
Yes. So as I was saying, each of us published a paper. I published the Christian Messenger, and Brother Campbell published the Millennial Harbinger. Back then, it was not uncommon for people to receive more than one newspaper, and there were several people that read both of our publications.
And it was those readers who first approached us about the idea of unifying our reform movements. They argued that Brother Stone and I had similar positions on many significant issues, which is true. Obviously, we don't agree on everything. I'm right on most of them. But our views are close enough that I agreed to explore the idea of bringing the movements together.
So there were meetings and there were written exchanges in our newspapers. And finally, on January 1st of 1832, we shook hands in Lexington, Kentucky. Although I should say, I did not actually shake hands with Brother Campbell here because he was not present.
Well, there were several reasons for that. I could not be there. But I had an able representative. I admit, however, that I was a bit skeptical of the idea of joining our two movements. Certainly we agreed on some things, many things, important things. And of course, Brother Stone had been a Presbyterian, as I had. Still, I had some reservations. I did not attend that meeting, but my friend, Raccoon John Smith, was there.
Yes.
Served there as my representative and shook hands with Brother Stone. Despite my skepticism, I went along with the merger, and as I look back on it, I believe now that it was the right thing to do, given that Brother Stone's insistence on an adequate name.
We are all Christians, are we not? In that case, we should be satisfied calling ourselves Christians. Nothing more is necessary.
Disciples is more descriptive.
Okay. We're running short on time. I want to ask you about these guiding principles referred to. You have mentioned two, looking to the New Testament as a guide for how we should live our faith, and the unity of believers. Would you explain those and any other principles that guided both of you?
I believe we can say there were four basic principles that guided our thinking. Let me mention them, and then we will explain briefly. One was individual freedom to study and interpret Scripture. A second was the need to restore as best we can the practices of those first century Christians. Third, we believe strongly in the unity of all believers. And finally, we saw that those three would come together to enable all disciples to be effective evangelists, bringing our new nation and the world to faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. That is how I would summarize the principles. Do you agree, Brother Stone?
Yes, I think you correctly identified them. I'm not sure we ever articulated them in quite that way, but I'm in agreement with you about those principles. They guided each of us in our belief that if Christians would apply them, the church would become the blessing that God intends it to be.
Well, we have just a few moments, so briefly, Mr. Campbell, would you explain the first of those principles, the one about individual freedom?
Yes, Brother Stone and I are both in agreement that each believer has the God-given freedom to study and interpret Scripture. We disagree with those churches that teach it is only the church that rightfully interprets Scripture, and that believers are to accept the church's interpretation without question. There is a role for preachers and teachers, to be sure, and they are necessary, even though some may doubt that. But the fact remains that each of you has the freedom to study the Scriptures, and I trust that you do, and the freedom to interpret it.
And Brother Campbell, if I may interject something here, that principle of individual freedom was very well received in the areas where we did preaching and teaching, because we were on the frontier, and on the frontier, individual freedom was prized above almost anything else.
Quite right.
Mr. Stone, would you have something to say about another of the principles, the unity of believers?
Absolutely. That's a principle I hold dear. I believe I mentioned earlier how impressed I was by the show of unity at the Cane Ridge camp meeting. There were Presbyterians, Methodists, Baptists, Anglicans, people from many, many denominations, and yet when it came to worship and the Lord's Supper, we were all Christians. I was distressed in my earlier days of preaching to witness the arguing among denominations, the differences in teaching, the insistence by some that a particular doctrine or creed be accepted. Unfortunately, things don't seem to change very much. A brother in Campbell and I are in agreement that the only creed necessary to our faith is the good confession, Jesus is the Christ, and nothing more need to be added. If Christians will accept that as their creed and set aside all these man-made doctrines and rules that have been created through the centuries, then unity will be possible, and it should be obvious that a unified voice for Christ will be the most effective.
Absolutely. You see, Brother Stone and I can disagree on some things, many things, but we can still work well together because we confess Jesus as the Christ. Brother Stone has some different ideas about certain issues, and I think he is in error about them, as he no doubt believes me to be in error. However, we are both committed to Jesus Christ, and indeed, that's what really matters.
Mr. Campbell, if we could stay with you, would you explain another one of the guiding principles, namely using the New Testament as a guide for the way to conduct our faith?
Well, first of all, I am a reasonable man. I am fully aware that times are much different today than they were when I was in Pennsylvania. Although in some ways I am not sure things are better today, I'm also quite aware that times now and when I was in Pennsylvania are much different than they were in the first century. Still, I believe the New Testament can serve as our primary guide to the conduct of faith. There were no elaborate church structures in the days of the disciples and the apostles. There were no bishops or priests who were considered to be closer to God than everyone else, and therefore the only ones to turn to for guidance in understanding Scripture and relating to the Lord. Now, faithful people gathered in local communities, worshiped together, partook of the Lord's Supper weekly, that is in Acts 20, spent considerable time in prayer and fellowship, and served one another in Jesus' name. There was not anything formal or fancy about it. They simply committed themselves to Jesus Christ. Now, I am convinced that the body of Christ, the church, will be the blessing it was intended to be when we spend more time doing what they did in the first century and less time preoccupied with human, man-made institutions.
Do you wish to add anything, Mr. Stone?
Absolutely not.
Well then, Mr. Stone, let us turn back to you and ask about the fourth guiding principle. If I understood correctly, you believe that effective evangelism requires a combination of the three principles we just discussed. Is that correct?
Yes, first, you are correct. And now let me explain. I share Brother Campbell's commitment to bringing people to faith in Jesus Christ. The Bible is quite clear. It would seem that confessing Jesus as the Christ, as Savior and Lord, is God's intention for all of humanity. It's also quite clear that Jesus calls us to go and make disciples to baptize and teach them in Jesus' name. Carrying out that calling would be absolutely impossible if Christians are not studying and interpreting God's Word, not speaking with a unified voice, and not looking to God's Word for guidance in conducting of a church's affairs. It seems to me rather simple, really. A biblically literate, unified voice for Jesus Christ will successfully bring people to faith in our risen Lord and Savior.
Mr. Campbell, do you wish to add anything?
Oh, nothing really, except to say that the principles that guided us in the beginning nearly 200 years ago are still I believe, very valid today. I hope you will implement them here at First Christian Church.
Amen.
Of Oklahoma City.